Hello. Thank you for joining us this evening. We're very glad to have you come and learn more about an amazing exhibit that Smithsonian Gardens hosts every other year. And we're sharing this with you because of the unique opportunities our planning can help you with your planning in your education programs, your lessons that you do every day. My name is Cindy Brown, and I will be your host. And I have two experts with me that are going to help us along for the evening. First, I'd like to share a PowerPoint with you, a presentation, to introduce you to this amazing team of community experts that we have. Then, I will share a video that we created to give you a behind-the-scenes look of what goes on to put together one of these amazing living exhibits. My name is Cindy Brown. I'm the Education and Collections Manager of Smithsonian Gardens. And welcome to Orchids, the Hidden Stories of Groundbreaking Women. Joining me is Virginia Thaxton. Virginia is a botanist as well as a horticulturist. And she will help us out with learning and answering, learning about the exhibit as well as answering questions at the end. And Melanie Pyle is one of our horticulturists that helps design this amazing exhibit. So I'm gonna say, hold on, ladies, we'll get back to you in just a bit. But first, I wanna go back to our presentation, our slide presentation, and make that the featured part. So let me introduce you to this amazing community of experts. Advance, please. And this is, I think, after you listen this evening and watch, see the amazing photographs and sketches, you'll understand how this is going to help you with the content and the concepts that you share perennially, and how they can be more engaging when community experts collaborate to add diverse perspectives. Advance, please. The team is made up of many players within Smithsonian Gardens. Marisa Scalera is our landscape architect, so her role is to be the exhibit designer and project manager. And she keeps us all together. She's the one that gets us together for meetings. She's the one that makes sure that everything advances, everything moves forward. She also holds the pocketbook to make sure that we don't overspend the exhibit. It's her job to get us to figure out how the exhibit every year will tie into our missions and our goals. What's the big idea for this year? What key messages do we want to share with our visitors? What are the critical questions, and what are the themes and sub-themes? I want you to know this one was planned for 2020, but because of our situation, the museum wasn't open, and so we're looking forward to it open this coming up 2022 in January. Advance. Melanie, as I said, she's our living collection designer, and she oversees the care of the collection and the exhibit. The exhibit needs, she's always thinking of these points. The exhibit needs to be effectively display the plants. The props have to blend in and enhance the design, not just stand out and be different from everything. It has to meld together. She's also very concerned that the plants must be displayed in an easily accessible manner, because they have to take care of these things. This is a living collection. These are orchids. These aren't just a number of interpretive panels put up. So it's very important. Advance, please. And Justin Kondrat is the horticulturist that maintains this amazing orchid collection that we have in our greenhouse. Greenhouses, I should say, because there's five greenhouses filled with different orchids of all types, sizes, shapes, colors. It's an amazing cornucopia of living things and living collection. He determines how the orchid collection can support the theme, because we change up the theme every other year. We're never doing the same thing, even though the major component of the exhibit is always orchids. Always, always, always. He decides what to showcase, and then he makes sure everything stays healthy and safe as it moves back and forth from the greenhouse to this year. It'll be the Kogod Courtyard, which is a courtyard in between the Smithsonian American Art Museum and the Smithsonian National Portrait Gallery. Advance, please. Sarah Hedin is our Living Collections Manager. She oversees the integrity of the Orchid Collections mission. We could buy numerous orchids that are pretty, but they might not fit our mission. They might just be a pretty face. We want something deeper. We want to make sure that it is an orchid that will fit our mission that we created years ago. She's responsible for the planning and implementation of activities that ensures the long-term preservation. And she also helps Justin and the orchid team figure out what acquisitions we need to acquire so that we can effectively support the exhibit. Next, please. Alex is another horticulturist that specializes in interior design. I highlight Alex in this because she is one of the scientists that helped us investigate and research the botanical illustrators and artists, a very important role this year. She decided who to feature for the botanical illustrators and artists, and she made sure that there were scientific viewpoints included in the exhibit, and they were well represented and accurate. Next, please. And Virginia. Virginia, as I said, is a biologist and horticulturist, and she helped research the women scientist in this exhibit. She is really important for many things, but two that I think are really important is she takes care of those orchids daily. She's in the Kogod Courtyard. She's making sure they're blooming well, they've been fertilized, they're watered, they're putting their best face forward because the beauty of our orchid exhibit is what first attracts visitors. Then when they come and they dive deeper into the subject, they understand the importance of all the different themes that we're trying to share with them. She's also a native Spanish speaker, and this is very important because this exhibit, like many of our exhibits, are in both English and in Spanish, so we can reach the audience that we need to reach, that we want to reach. We want to reach out to the community and be able to tell them a story in a way that they will understand it. So that's the team, that's our community of experts. Who do you have within your school, within your community, that could help you with their expertise to bring more information, a different twist, make something that's exciting so those students are going to be hanging on every word, just like our visitors hang on every, well, not physically hang on every orchid, but figuratively hang on what we're trying to share and teach with them. So I'm going to mute and I'm going to ask for this amazing video to be shared with you so you meet each team member and hear from them what they thought their importance was to bring to the exhibit. I'll see you after the video.
Good afternoon. I am Marisa Scalera, landscape architect with Smithsonian Gardens, and I am speaking to you today from the Kogod Courtyard in the Donald W. Reynolds Center for American Art and Portraiture. This is the site of our 2022 Orchid Exhibition and seemed like the perfect place to talk to you about exhibit development and exhibit design process. First, stepping back to talk a little bit about the history of our orchid exhibits. This is the 26th year of our collaboration with the U.S. Botanic Garden. For the last 26 years, we've been co-hosting an annual orchid exhibition with USBG. The exhibit alternates sites, alternates locations. Every other year, Smithsonian Gardens co-hosts. In 2022, it's our turn to host. Each year, at the close of one exhibit that we've hosted, we begin planning for the next exhibit that Smithsonian Gardens will host. So in 2019, at the close of our amazing adaptations orchid exhibit, we began thinking about our orchid exhibit that will come in 2022. This orchid exhibit began with the kernel of an idea. This was an idea that was brought to our orchid exhibit team by Smithsonian Gardens Museum specialist Kelly Crawford. She had the idea, what if we were to think about an orchid exhibit that centered around the work of Mary Box Walcott? Mary Box Walcott is an American illustrator and naturalist, and she has a collection of her illustrations here in the Smithsonian American Art Museum, which is also located here at the Donald W. Reynolds Center. So it seemed like a perfect pairing. So my role in this project as landscape architect, exhibit designer, and project manager is to shepherd this exhibit through the exhibit development process and the exhibit design process, working with our full Smithsonian Gardens team, many of whom you will meet during this session today, and also with our colleagues across the institution, including and particularly colleagues from Smithsonian Exhibits. They brought to our team a exhibit developer, a exhibit designer, a graphic designer, a script writer, and a project manager who assisted in the development of this exhibition. I had the great pleasure of working closely with that full team to develop this exhibit.
My role with the development of the design is more of a grand scheme planner. My initial duties with Smithsonian Gardens is designing interior exhibits, but I've morphed into more of a generalist's role in that I interact with the orchid collection staff, the designers of Smithsonian exhibits, any curators that were involved with the specific museums where our exhibit is being displayed, along with our interior staff, our greenhouse staff, and any members of our exterior staff that want to partake in the installation and deinstallation of our exhibit.
My role with the orchid exhibition was to be a member of the core team. We helped pick a theme, work on the script, design, research the different women. I was assigned to research botanical artists and botanical illustrators. So first I started by doing a search and just bringing together a whole list of different artists and illustrators. And then I narrowed it down even more and looked specifically for women that had illustrated different orchids, because this is an orchid exhibition. So once we got the list, which was quite a long one, we brought it back to the core team and we went through each woman and their different stories and narrowed it down to ones that had not only amazing artwork or illustrations that were scientifically accurate, but also had really interesting stories.
I think I can best describe my role in the exhibit by talking about the three tasks that I had. First of all, I am a horticulturist and a biologist, so I'm one of the scientists of the group. That means I was tasked with researching all the women orchidologists, which are the scientists that study orchids. So we wanted to find women to highlight in our panels, and we wanted them to come from different time periods, to have accomplished things in their field and had unique stories. So we have this criteria for choosing them. We also wanted to highlight one of our own Smithsonian scientists. So based on this criteria, I researched online a lot of women orchidologists and came up with a list of 11 of them. But since we could only fit three in our science panel, then came a process of selection. That meant I needed to get to know them better. So reading articles and even biographical books that were done about them. For our own scientists, I went to personally interview her, tour the research lab that she works at. All this research goes on so we can best choose who's gonna be highlighted in the panels. The three we chose include an Australian naturalist who's very well known for her groundbreaking research done with orchid pollination. Then there's also a Polish scientist. She works currently at a university in Poland and she's a plant taxonomist. So she's named and revised over 400 species of orchids. And then our own researcher, she works for the Smithsonian Environmental Research Center doing orchid, native and tropical orchid research in ecology. When working on researching the script, we not only had to provide written content, but also choose the images that were going on the panels. A moment I remember nicely is that related to the orchid taxonomies, I wanted to choose an image that was not just another orchid photo. So I decided it would be really neat to show people what a specimen at a herbarium looks like. So I went online to Kew Gardens. They have this catalog of all the herbaria specimens that are found around the world. And I found orchids that she has named and found a really good photo that depicts how that looks. And I wanted to be a didactic image for people to learn about taxonomy. A second role I had was to help with the bilingual panels. As the museums and the Smithsonian Gardens always want to include two languages when possible. In this case, it is Spanish. And since I'm a Spanish speaker and a scientist, I was able to help revise the official translation. And in this case, I can provide revisions with the technological biological terms and help make sure that the translation is the correct one for our exhibit. And a final minor role I had, in this case, is due to the fact that I'm the horticulturist that takes care of this space on a weekly basis. Sometimes I was asked to take on-site measurements. For example, if we want to put prop elements in the beds, where should they go? I knew exactly where the root systems of the trees were. We don't want to damage our collection trees. So helping measure where do we put the elements. Also, sometimes gadgets that we wanted to use to hold them in the soil. Is our soil good for the kind of things we want to use? So I tested those. Or for example, once we chose a surface for the elements, we wanted to test the opacity, so bring it over to the side, look at it at different times of day to determine which reflectivity was going to be better for us. Things that related to on-site measurements I was able to do because I come here on a weekly basis.
The role I played was we did a lot of research trying to find the stories of women, especially related to orchid cultivation, orchid teaching about orchids through publications, as well as women who were collectors of orchids or sought orchids in the wild. It was quite an interesting experience, and I learned a lot before I really hadn't heard these stories of the women that are highlighted in the exhibition. The role of a collection manager is to document, describe, and conserve, and build your collection moving forward. So I have a team, on the Living Collections team, we have folks who accession plants, who catalog those plants, and to really build out those descriptive records. We have a photographer who takes pictures of our living collections so that we can use them for reference to be sure the taxonomy is correct, also to help educate our public about our collection. And then we also do a lot of things as a collection technician, helping us to create labels and to label our plants and to georeference them if they're in the gardens versus being inside the greenhouse.
So my role within the exhibition was making sure that we had collection items ready for the exhibition, but also when it came to the planning, I was looking through our collection archives and our collection holdings and making sure that we would have collection items for display during the exhibition. Also, in preparation for the exhibition, prepping all the plants, getting them ready for exhibition, also organizing the transportation to the exhibition.
So we built an exhibit based on this idea, these hidden stories of these groundbreaking women who have made huge strides in their respective fields as they pertain to orchids. And so we began with a big idea. We developed our key messages. We thought through our critical questions, thought through how we could tie this back into a larger exhibit. And what we have today is Orchids, Hidden Stories of Groundbreaking Women. It highlights the work of 15 women across a variety of different types of fields, spanning from art through science.
Essentially, when we design an orchid exhibit, we have to remember that the primary aspect of the design and of the overall theme of the exhibit is the fact that we're displaying live plants and we're displaying collection pieces, and any content that is within this exhibit has to primarily not only tell the story that we want to convey to the public, but also really highlight the orchids. And in turn, the orchids that we select for the design has to highlight the content. So although neither one can overpower the other, they both have to meld together. And then a third aspect is any props you use need to complement both of those as well. So it's a multifaceted process of getting everything not only to complement each other, but when you install it, it all has to look like it's fluid and there's no, everything just works within the other piece, and they all work together to develop this overall view of for the public.
What I brought to the exhibition team was, I'm a seasoned horticulturist with Smithsonian Gardens. I've worked on multiple orchid exhibitions in the past, so I have a feeling of how they work and can bring that know-how from past exhibitions. I am also a designer for and project manager for multiple other exhibitions that Smithsonian Gardens has done. And I am an environmental science major, so I also bring the scientific know-how and actually helped with some other members make sure that the science was well represented and that science was accurate within the exhibition. A point that we really wanted to drive home is the difference between a botanical illustrator and a botanical artist. So a botanical illustrator, the emphasis is on science rather than visual art. There are true and lifelike representations of the plant. You should highlight the plant's particular distinguishing features, which enable botanists to tell one plant from another. This also includes accurate measurements of different plant parts. The illustrators consult with botanists, and their work is judged on scientific accuracy, not beauty, even though most of them tend to be very beautiful as well. And if you look at the image on the left, this is an example of a botanical illustration. If we move over to botanical artists, that is, their work is not intended for use in scientific publications. They're often drawn as plants in their natural habitat. It doesn't need to depict all the parts of the plant and does not need to be scientifically accurate. It emphasizes artistic expression, as you can see on the drawing on the right.
When it comes to the viewpoints, I think I also brought three viewpoints. The first one is that of the female scientist. Being a scientist, I was always concerned with making sure we got the science right. That's important to me. The second viewpoint would be the one of a Spanish speaker. For example, when we were choosing a title for the exhibit, I wanted to make sure it translated well. And for example, one of the cases was, no, that's not translatable. That doesn't relate to Spanish speakers. So it's good to have somebody that speaks the language that we're also representing in the exhibit or translating to. And the third viewpoint would be the one of the horticulturist on site. Because I'm here weekly, I'm also gonna take care of the orchids when they're here. It gives a perspective of how to best place things in the beds, making sure we take care of the plantings.
Well, the viewpoint that I bring as a living collections manager is thinking about the collection from a long-term preservation and conservation perspective. We have this collection and we need to maintain it within all of its necessary cultural requirements, as well as having the right resources to build the collection moving forward. So I think I brought a holistic approach to collections management and stewardship to this project.
So the viewpoint I brought was, of course, the plant geek inside of me and also the orchophile. I love orchids and love anything about orchids. And so it was really nice to kind of put my input and my twist from a horticulture standpoint within the exhibition, and also telling the story and the history of orchids in the US and the world.
I think some of the challenges we face is actually the how we get the plants from point A to point B. This collection is held off-site in a greenhouse facility that's nearly 7 miles from the location where the exhibition takes place. This exhibition also takes place in the winter time. So imagine taking tropical plants out of their tropical environment, putting them onto carts, and then loading them into vehicles to transport them, and then offloading them. It's a lot of moving parts. And many of these orchids are very sensitive to temperature variations, as well as some of the orchid blossoms, their flower spikes can be very brittle. So you have to be very careful. Just thinking about how many people are involved in this process from start to finish, from Justin on site working with the collection to volunteers that are helping, interns that help, contractors, and then moving the plants to the next location, and then taking them off the carts and putting them into the exhibition. There's a lot of people involved in that process, and we want to be very thoughtful and conscious about handling the plants properly. So I think that probably, to me, is one of the largest challenges. We've done this over so many years that we've really gotten very good at growing these beautiful plants. It's more the challenge of moving them from point A to point B.
Some of the challenges that we've been able to excel in is dealing with a living orchid collection. You can imagine this one greenhouse that we're standing in has over 2,000 plants in it, and there's three more, so a total of four houses. So you can imagine there's a lot of moving parts. And also with living collections, something might be blooming one day, the next day it fades, or it could be deaccession because it is no longer in the collection. A living collection also fluctuates in terms of numbers and what we actually have in our collection when it comes to our collection goals and our stewardship plan. Our collection here, as you see, is just getting ready and bursting at the seams, ready to go on display for the exhibition. It's one of the challenges is just making sure that all the pieces align and making sure that the climate and climate control greenhouses align with the blooming of the orchids, and also align with our exhibition dates and planning and getting them prepped and on for display. Also, integrated pest management, so making sure that the insects are not on the collection items and making sure that they're free of various pathogens. That's a big thing with living collections. So they're again making sure that we're not contaminating other collections within the museums or our partners that we work with, similar as the U.S. Botanic Garden. And so there again, just making sure that our collection items are held safe and safeguarded while on display.
Our goal with this is to draw the public in with the with our orchid collection, draw the public in with these large-scale representations of orchids, large orchid botanical illustrations, large-scale orchid art, draw the public in with this beautiful display, and then be able to hook them and get the public interested and thinking about the stories of these women, the hidden stories of these groundbreaking women.
As educators, one of our primary goals is also to make sure that the story we are telling is conveyed to the public in a way that they'll understand it, they'll learn from it, and they'll walk away with something from the exhibit. And I guess also what we want to do, what my goal is as a designer, is to, as I mentioned previously, to not let one of these aspects overpower the other. The public will understand that the important story is told because we feel it's something that they can take away from the exhibit. And also we want to make sure that they understand the importance of our collection piece. And we want, as stewards of our orchid collection, the Smithsonian Gardens Orchid Collection, it is our duty to bring this collection to the public every other year when we host it here, and then every other year when the Botanic Gardens hosts it. But we want to show the public that that orchids are so varied, and they're not just beautiful blooms. They're important in so many ways, and how they've inspired the women that we're featuring in this exhibit to become more involved in the study of orchids, the artistic interpretation of orchids, how those women were really, really connected to these plants. We want the public to also feel that connection, and we really are able to achieve that by this amazing design that you'll see, this amazing collection of plants, and this really well thought out interpretation that our Smithsonian Exhibits group has presented for you, for the public rather. And I believe that once the public goes through this, because we've received the money from the American Women's History Initiative to really take this exhibit to the next level, the design of the exhibit just reached a whole nother echelon, and we are able to incorporate other aspects of this beautiful space into the design, not just the beds.
I really hope that little girls come to this exhibit, and also young, older women as well, and just feel empowered by the stories of these different women through time, and can realize that women are important in science and art, and it's okay to follow your dreams, and you can make a difference. Don't worry about what other people think.
I hope that the public really appreciates how amazing it is to put together all these women with empowering stories that contribute to the art and science of the world of orchids. But most importantly, being a scientist, I'm so excited about the fact that we're going to be inspiring young girls that want to potentially pursue a career in science, and they can see examples of what other women have done in the field. So that's really exciting to me.
I really hope that the public learns that women have been part of this orchid story, although, you know, I hadn't really heard much about women who were involved with orchids before this project. And so I really hope they realize that there's a voice for women and people of color who haven't been highlighted in the orchid stories of the past, and that we can see there's a place for everyone working and enjoying orchids.
Yes, yeah, so I hope everyone learns how fabulous and wonderful orchids are and how diverse they are, but also that orchids are for everybody. One of the most exciting things about the family Orchidaceae, aka the orchid family, is their diversity. Whether it's their size, their color, their fragrance, how they grow, epiphyte growing on a tree, terrestrial on the ground. You can see here we've pulled just a few examples from our collection that highlights the biodiversity of the orchids within our collection. Beautiful Cattleya, which is the corsage orchid, beautiful Phragmipedium, a Psychopsis over here, more Cattleyas, Phragmipedium, and then a Habenaria medusa. So it's really cool seeing as they bloom. You never know what you're gonna get. And what's lovely about managing this collection is you kind of forget, but once they bloom, it's like meeting an old friend again.
Well, we're back. Thank you. I think that video really effectively communicated how important it is to have all these experts help out in developing the orchid exhibit. I'm only one voice. I'm the educator. It's my job to think about the visitor experience. It's my job to think about the people, not just the objects, not just the living collection, but the people. But that's only one voice, and it wouldn't be near as robust without these wonderful experts that join together, collaborate, and put on these amazing exhibits to share all kinds of ideas. So how can you learn from that? First off, I want to say we learned something from this, making this video. We made this video for you so you could see behind the scenes of the orchid exhibit. But then we realized what a powerful message it was that we had taped that we'd be able to share with our stakeholders. Think of what you could do with your students if you chronicled a project and taped or videoed that, videoed that so that they could see all the impact they were having together as a team. Your principal could see, your PTA members could see. Everyone in the school would be so proud to be able to understand this. So we're going to show this to all our stakeholders. It's hard to imagine what it's like in a museum when you're working with material collections, what it's like to work with a living collection. It's that added dimension that makes it so exciting. So with that, we're opening it to questions, and we'd hope you have something to ask. But I have a question for Virginia and Melanie, and you both can answer one at a time. We have stressed so much in this video the importance of using primary sources. When we're doing the research, we're not just going on Wikipedia and go, that sounds good. What can you pull out? Virginia, what can you tell us about the importance that you found in going to the sources, whether it be an archive or the real person, to be able to choose scientists for this exhibit?
Oh, it's absolutely so important. Definitely. I mean, I have a teenager son in high school, so I know what it's like to try to do research or search things up on the internet. And yes, a lot of things come up, but you need to feel that you trust them. So you want to look for, you know, the ones that end in .edu, anything that comes from a university, from a research center. Like I said, like when I was looking for images, I looked at Kew Gardens, is like the world authority on taxonomy and herbaria. When we were looking at the woman, exactly, go. I read a book about one of them. It's not just the little article that's published online, but go find the biography, go find the true source that tells you the real story. So I always go for trusted sites for sure. And that's something that, like I said, I teach to my son when he's doing research for school.
That's great. And Melanie, you, I will say, interviewed all different sources to be able to bring this exhibit come alive with trellises and huge aluminum panels. What did you do for primary sources so that you could make sure the materials that you, or that we are using in the exhibit, are gonna be effective?
Well, we are very lucky to have an exhibits team that can pretty much make anything to our specifications that we need. Anything, I mean, it really helps bring all of the elements together, having your own production facility. But, you know, a lot of the stuff, obviously you go to the internet, see what you can find, sources there. With experience, you come to know which companies offer the best items. It's a lot of research, and a lot of times you don't find specifically what you want, and then you either have to change the direction you're going in, or you know, see if you can find an independent source to fabricate something for you. But it's a lot, just like Virginia spent many, many hours researching scientific fact. Finding the artistic side can be just as challenging.
Yeah, I agree. So questions are coming in, and someone would like to know, what are some of the classroom activities we have on women and orchid cultivation? So I'll start, but I want you to chime in too. So we have learned about the power of videos, short videos, and how the videos can reach out to students and everybody actually to be able to give different viewpoints. So we've already created a set of videos that highlights women in gardens and landscaping. And we're going to be creating another set of videos on these women that are in the exhibit. The historic women, of course, we won't be able to interview them, but we'll be able to add sketches and images and images and stories about them in these videos. We also, and Melanie and Virginia have both done this, helped create activities that says, what's an orchid? How do you tell? So Virginia, how do you tell what an orchid is?
Oh, how do I tell?
Yeah.
It has very specific botanical characteristics when it comes to flower parts, for example. Normally flowers may have like 5-6 petals, but in this case, the petals are very unique. They have an asymmetry of like 3 and 3 that alternate. And one of the petals is an adaptation called a labellum, because they provide the landing spot for pollinators for orchids. And that creates a lot of diversity in their evolution. Orchids also have tremendous like bulbs and pseudobulbs, and their leaves are so different. But it's mostly the flower parts that shows us that it is an orchid.
So that's just one example of something that we have online to help you with orchids and what are they or what they are. So we do other activities like that as well, and they're all on our website. And we also are looking at this to see what we can do to inspire future orchid exhibits. So Melanie, and your experience with this orchid exhibit, how do you think this is going to inspire us for future exhibits?
Well, you know, the space the exhibit is in offers so much more to us from a display standpoint. having eight individual beds allows us to the potential to tell eight different stories, as long as it's interacted or as long as it all ties in together to the overall message. But, you know, and this exhibit, we luckily received a huge grant to help us, as I mentioned in my video, add so much more to the overall design. But with that, we also had access to a whole nother team of people that opened up potential for additional storylines to tie into our overall theme. And I think that it, for me personally, I think that it's inspired me to really go out and look for other ways to tie into other divisions of the Smithsonian and highlight areas that haven't been highlighted before, and then just figure out how you're going to tie the orchids to that theme. It forces us to be more creative with each and every show we do.
Yep, it's going back to that community. Find out what's important to your community and use those experts to make a difference. So I think we've learned that time and time again, the community is so important, whatever your community may be, whether it's school or the PTA or whatever it is, reach out to that community and find out what topics are of interest to them and then move forward on that. So now, what other garden resources do we have in Spanish? And I have a very good one that I think you all may be interested in. We did an orchid exhibit several years ago at Natural History Museum, and it was all about orchids of Latin America, because most of our orchids are tropical orchids from Latin America. So Melanie, you want to say what we did with the videos and how we included Spanish in that activity and or those activities in that exhibit?
Well, I certainly wish Virginia had been here. Been here then, because she really could have helped us with that. And, you know, our goal for, as far as the design aspect of that was to really give the visitor a feel like they were in Latin America, whether it was in the rainforest or whether it was in our entrance, which was this beautifully constructed pavilion area that it had a fountain in the center of it, and it was just from our aspect really trying to convey what it was like, in at least from our perspective, in Latin America, and doing the dual translation of the text was probably our first attempt at doing yes. Could have used you then, Virginia.
Yeah, we could have, but we did very well because we interviewed other orchid experts and scientists from other Latin American countries. So we were a little bit ahead of your time, Virginia, but we're right.
The website we're creating for this orchid exhibit is a good idea to put links to actual Spanish language like garden sites. So I'll promise to work on looking for some of those.
That would be great. One thing that we did with the Latin American exhibit too was to add some history to it, so that we showed the countries that were involved, that were represented by orchids, and we shared the flag, we shared cultural information. It was really fun to add that depth to it, and we're going to be doing more of that in the future. Okay, here's the tough one. I have no idea. How many different kinds of orchids has the Smithsonian documented? How many live species do you care for every year? And can my students come help document somehow? That's a good question. First, start with how many we have.
Yeah, I think our collection now is smaller than it used to be. It was as high as 10,000 plants at one point, but I think we're whittling it down to about 6,000 at this point. Just so we're more efficient with what we take care of, and allowing the plants to grow more in a more healthy environment. Virginia, you want to add?
Yeah, and like Justin said, make sure we have the variety of species that really support our mission. It's at about 6,000 right now, mostly tropical. And now the Smithsonian, North American Orchid Conservation Center, where our orchid scientist works, they do work with native orchids. So they cover that. One thing I wanted to say is our collection does have about 6,000 species. And on this exhibit, you'll see represented about 500 of them on any given day. Mm-hmm. But as Sarah was mentioning, the challenge is moving them. And as Justin was mentioning, they're living things. So sometimes they fade. And throughout the whole 3 months of the exhibit, we have to change our orchids about twice a week. So can you imagine that process of going from the tropical house through the cold winter in a truck to the loading dock of the museum? We do that twice a week. And I'm always checking, is the flower fading? And at the end of every week, I give Justin a list. Okay, these many flowers are faded. So next week, we bring in about between 30 and 50 plants every week to continually having fresh. But we do display a lot of species at one time. So whoever visits on one day gets to see 500 species or cultivars. Not all of them are true species, but it is an amazing collection, and it's so worth showing it to the public.
It is, and one of the reasons we went from 10,000 species or cultivars down to 6 is because we're very concerned about virus protection. Orchids, like many plants, get viruses, and for some reason, orchids seem to be more virus prone than any other plants that I've ever worked with. And so we're bringing it down so that we have true, good, healthy, virus-free orchids. So that's a science within orchidology that we didn't do 50 years ago. We weren't as concerned. In fact, some of our favorite spots and colors and everything else were due to viruses until we thought, oh my gosh, we're breeding, making these unhealthy orchids. So that's one thing. I love this question. What do you think the skills of the next generation of conservation biologists should learn? What have you found to be important yourself? And we only have about 3 minutes left, but can you do something?
As a biologist, I want to say truly one of the most important ones is passion for plants, the passion for nature. You got to love it first, and then make sure you document yourself. You really learn what the status of things are. You're always reading new research, new papers, to really be able to make a difference, to go out there and change things. But love and passion for nature is the first step.
How about you, Melanie? Did you play outside a lot as a kid?
Oh, yes, I did. And come from, a long line of horticulturists. But to me, it's, yes, there is the passion and the curiosity and the desire to understand why something works. But at the end of the day, you just have to feel something in your heart when you look at a plant. And you can't really put your mind around what it is that draws you into it. But you know, it's something that moves you deeply. And that'll keep you going through the more mundane aspects of science.
I agree, because I was going to suggest two of the skills that I found to be very helpful. I'm a edible food expert, so I talk a lot on vegetables. And the only reason that I understood what I was looking at is because I observed and I observed and I observed, and I took records from year after year after year. So those two skills will never get stale. We've got to teach people students how to observe and how to record what they observe. In fact, this comes to a project that we're working on right now, making pollinator posters available to teachers through sites. You'll see that on our website soon. And journals, how to create journals, how to look, how to just sit down and look and observe. I think we're out of time. It said 2 minutes left. I'm watching just to see they don't cut us off, but 1 minute left in the program. Okay, so what's your favorite part about this entire exhibit in 2 words? I know, all right, three.
For me, it is the ability to change it, to look different every week and keep people coming back.
Okay, that's pretty good. How about Virginia?
Caring for them, watering orchids, misting them. It's just the smell, the just being there with them all the time is really special.
So who do you have in your community that's passionate, observant, can keep records, can converse with other experts? It makes a heck of a lot of difference. We hope to see you at Smithsonian Gardens. Oh, and for the person that wanted to know how they could help, my information is on the Smithsonian Gardens website. Email me. We'll talk. Thanks to everyone. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye. Okay.